Hello friends, welcome to Engineering Simplified. Today I am going to solve a problem related to design of RCC cantilever retaining wall. The problem statement I have taken from Design of Reinforced Concrete Structure book written by N. Krishna Raju. The problem statement is as follows. We have to design a cantilever retaining wall, okay, so that we can retain an earthen embankment 4 meter high from the ground level. The density of the soil is 18 kilonewton per meter cube, angle of repose is 30 degree, and the embankment is horizontal at top. The safe bearing capacity of soil is 200 kilonewton per meter square. Coefficient of friction between soil and concrete is 0.5, and the materials properties are given as M20 concrete and Fe415 steel we are taking to construct this RCC cantilever retaining wall. Okay, so first step will be, what are the data given for designing? What are the data? The first data, we know that what is the height of embankment above ground level? Okay, this is the height of embankment above ground level. It is 4 meter. We represent it as H1. Okay, and we know the gamma unit weight of soil is given as 18 kilonewton per meter cube. And we know angle of internal friction phi is 30 degree. Allowable bearing capacity of soil is 200 kilonewton per meter square. Okay. Then angle of the coefficient of friction between the soil and concrete is 0.5. And the material properties are, the grade of concrete is M20, the characteristic strength of concrete will be 20 newton per mm square, grade of steel is 415, so yield strength of the steel is 415 newton per mm square. So what will be the diagrammatic representation of the whole system? This is the ground level. Okay, from ground level, the top of the embankment is horizontal. Okay, it is horizontal, and this level difference is 4 meter. Okay, this is the data given in the question. Okay, now let us solve the problem. The first step will be, we have to know the dimensions of various parts of the cantilever retaining wall. So we'll solve the problem. First we have to find out the, what should be the minimum depth of foundation. Let we represent it by small d, capital D. To calculate the minimum depth of foundation, we can use Rankine's formula. You can find it in any geotechnical engineering, standard geotechnical engineering book. What is the Rankine's formula? The D, the minimum depth of foundation required, equal to the ratio of allowable bearing capacity by the soil unit weight of soil multiplied by 1 minus sin phi by 1 plus sin phi whole square. So we know the allowable bearing capacity, it is 200. We know the unit weight of soil, this is 18. We know the phi value is 30 degree, 1 minus sin 30 by 1 plus sin 30 whole square. When we solve it, we will find out as 1.2 meter. So from ground level, the depth of foundation is 1.2 meter. So the overall depth of the wall will be 1.2 meter plus 4 meter, that is 5.2 meter. Let represent the overall depth H, capital H. Okay. Now, we have to proportion various parts of the retaining wall. For proportioning various parts of retaining wall, I am giving you some thumb rules. Okay. There are some thumb rules present. The thickness of the base slab, okay. This thickness of the base slab, okay. This thickness of the base slab, this is the base slab. What is its thickness? The thickness of the base slab is between overall depth by 12 to H by 15. We can take any value from between this value. This H is the overall depth, that is the summation of foundation depth plus level difference between ground level and top level of embankment. Okay. But the minimum thickness, it should not be less than 300 mm, means it should not be less than 30 centimeter. The thickness of the base slab should not be less than 30 centimeter, and it should be between H by 12 to H by 15. This is just a thumb rule. It is not means after a lot of practical experience, the researcher have given these thumb rules. Okay. For easier calculation, okay. The top width of the stem means, as we know, the active earth pressure increases downward, okay. So at the top, we don't need to give the same depth, the same width as that of the bottom. So at the top, the minimum width should be 200 mm. It can be greater than 200 mm, but it can't be lesser than. Okay. The bottom width of the stem, this bottom width, it is designed as for so that it can resist the maximum bending moment due to the active earth pressure. But for initial trial, we are taking it as a ratio of H by 12 to H by 8. That is, here H is overall depth, okay. The width of the base slab means what is the means width of the base slab. We know the thickness of the base slab is H by 12 to H by 5. What is the width of the base slab? Okay. Let it represent as B. This B, the width of the base slab is between 0.5 times of H to 0.6 times of H when no surcharge is present. Surcharge means additional load over the top level. Sorry. It's a top level. If an additional soil is present or above this top level, then it will be taken as surcharge. If additional load will be present, then it should be taken as surcharge. If there is no surcharge, then it will be taken as 0.5H to 0.6H. If there is surcharge is present, then the base width will be more and we can take it as 0.7H. This is a thumb rule. We can take more bulkier dimension, but it will make our structure more uneconomical, and sometime it may cause heavier load and it may cause bearing capacity failure. Okay. The toe projection means this width is called toe projection. Generally, we are taking it at B by 3, means if the total width of the base slab is B, then toe projection is 1/3 of the total width of the base slab. Okay. Now we are going to proportionate everything as per the thumb rule I have given. Okay. So what is the thickness of So what will be the our thickness of base slab? I am taking it h by 12. I have already told you it is between h by 12 to h by 15. I am taking h by 12 for higher safety. It will be 5.2. I have already told you 5.2 is the overall depth. It is a summation of the level difference between ground level and the top level and our depth of foundation. Okay, it will be 5.2 divided by 12. Okay, 5.2 divided by 12, it will be 433 mm. So but in practical situation it is difficult to give, means it is difficult to construct by taking this type of number. So we are taking a nearest whole number, we are taking 450 mm. So it will be easier to give direction to the contractor or the agency or the laborer to construct. Okay, so we know the thickness of the base slab. Now what is the height of the stem? Okay, what is the height of the stem? This step we call it as a height of the stem, we represent it as by small h. Now we found out what is our thickness of the stem, thickness of the base slab. We found out the thickness of the base slab as 450 mm. So we can subtract the thickness of the base slab from overall depth and we can find out the height of the stem. So height of the stem will be h minus 450. It will be 4.45. Okay, if we are representing it as a meter, so it will be 4.75 meters. Okay, now we know the thickness of the base slab. Now the thickness of stem at base, means what is the thickness of the stem at this level. Okay, we are generally taking it as same as that of thickness of the base slab. As we know, it is between h by 12 to h by 8. So it will be h by 12 and it will be nearly 450 mm. Okay, now what is the width of the base slab? I have told you the width of the base slab is between 0.5h to 0.6h. So 0.5h means it is 2.6 meter to 3.12 meter. Here h is the overall depth, that is 5.2. Okay, so let us take the width of the base slab as between this 2.6 to 3.12, we are considering as 3 meter. Okay, now the toe projection. Okay, I have told you what is the toe projection. 1/3 of width of the base slab means 3 by 3, this is 1 meter. Okay, now I am representing all these in the diagram. Okay, our thickness of the base slab is 450 mm. Total width of base slab is 3 meter. Okay, our stem width at the base is that we are taking similar to that of thickness of the base slab, that is 450 mm. Okay, our toe projection, yes, toe projection is 1/3 of this total 3, it will be 1 meter, toe projection is 1 meter, this is 450 mm, okay. So this will be 1.55 meter, okay. From the ground level, the depth of foundation is 1.2 meter. The level difference is 4 meter. The overall depth is the summation of 4 meter plus 1.2 meter will be h equal to 5.2 meter, okay. The height of stem will be subtraction of between 5.2 to 4.45 meter. If let it be a small h, it will be equal to 5.2 minus 0.45, okay. It will be 4.75 meter, okay. We have done the basic proportioning. This is stem, this is toe, this is heel, okay, and this total is called base slab. Now we will go for design of stem. Now let us design the stem part, okay. We know the height of stem is 4.75 meter, okay. While designing, we have to consider the stem as a fixed slab, okay. Means at this point it is fixed. We have to design the stem as a fixed slab. When we design a slab, what we consider? We consider a unit width, okay. We are considering a unit width means 1 meter width, means if it will convert into mm, it will 1000 mm of beam, okay. As load, I am drawing a 2 dimensional, as the active earth pressure is acting in triangularly, means it is varying linearly downward, it will try to bend it like in this fashion, okay. So tension will occur in the inner face, means in the this inner face tension will occur. So we have to give the main reinforcement in this face, okay. Prior to giving the main reinforcement, we have to calculate what will be the bending moment, okay. As we know, the height, this the total length at which the load will be act as a small h. Load is acting linear, it is varying linearly, maximum at bottom, minimum and zero at top. So maximum load at bottom will be Ka gamma h. If we draw the bending moment diagram, the bending moment will vary parabolically. Maximum at bottom, the maximum bending moment at bottom is 1 by 6 of Ka gamma h cube, okay. If you want to calculate, you can just take it, the load is acting triangularly, okay. If instead of giving the linearly varying load and depending as a resultant load, the resultant load, the value of the resultant load will be the area of this triangular load acting as a distance of h by 3. From this also we will find out this same value, okay. If in this question, now we will calculate the maximum bending moment. The maximum bending moment m 1 by 6th of Ka, this is gamma of soil, okay, h cube 1 by 6th We know the formula of Ka means coefficient of active earth pressure is 1 minus sin phi by 1 plus sin phi. Okay, gamma of soil is given as 18, and h means height of the stem, that is 4.75 whole cube, and phi is here 30 degree. When we will put it, we will get a value of 107.17, and unit is kilo newton meter. Okay, now while design, this is the service movement. Okay, that is a, what will be the design movement? Our design movement will be 1.5. The design movement or ultimate movement, we are representing it mu. It will be multiplied 1.5 times of m, means this maximum movement. Means as a concept, we know while designing as per limit state, we are increasing the load amount by 50%. Okay, for safety. So as load is increasing, that means the movement, we are increasing the movement, and so therefore we are multiplying 1.5 times. Okay, for design state of means limit state of collapse, we are using this formula, and if we multiply 1.5 times into m, that is the 107.17, we will get a value of 161 kilo newton per meter. If we represent it as newton per mm, as most of our dimension we are taking as mm, then it will be 161 into 10 to the power 6 newton mm. Okay. Now, as I have told you previously, we will design the stem as a fixed slab. Okay. So, we are taking 1 meter width of the slab, and the main enforcement will be, as it is bending in this direction, okay, in this fashion, it is bending in this fashion, the main enforcement will be provided vertically, okay, and distribution will be provided horizontally, distribution enforcement. You have already studied in design of slabs, okay. As we are providing a main enforcement horizontally, so it will look like a beam, okay, beam of width B, that is the 1000 mm, and overall depth, okay, D. Okay, we know if it is the reinforcement are engine like this, and the centered of the reinforcement, this is the effective depth, okay, this is clear cover, and this is half of the diameter of the reinforcement. Now we have to find that what initially we have taken the width, that the initial dimension of the width of the stem, is it correct or we have to change it. Okay, to find out this, we are going to use the clause G.1.1c of IS 456, okay, 2000. In that code, we know how to find the limiting bending moment using the equation 0.36 FCK XU by D balanced section 1 minus 0.42 XU by D balanced BD square FCK. Okay, if we know the FCK means grade of concrete and the width of the grade of concrete, and XU balanced by D, it depends upon, it is a function of our steel, grade of steel. Okay, for Fe415, XU by D is 0.48, and if we put it, our limiting bending moment will be 0.138 FCK BD square. Okay, for balanced section, if we are taking the mu, what we have mu, we have taken, we have found out, that is 161.10 to 6, and we will calculate the effective depth. Okay, the effective depth will be mu by 0.138 fck b root. Okay, this is 161 to the power 10 to the power 6, 0.138 fck is 20, and as it is a take, we are considering as a beam, the width will be 1000 mm. Okay. Okay, we will found out as 252 mm. Okay. Let us assume we are going to give 16 mm diameter of main reinforcement. Okay, and clear cover of 40 mm. Then our total, I mean overall depth will be effective depth plus 5/2 means diameter of half of the diameter of the main reinforcement plus clear cover. Okay, that will be 242 plus 8 plus 40, it will be 290 mm. Let's take it 300 mm. Okay, but initially we have assumed this D as 450 mm. Okay, and for a balance section we are getting the total depth as 300 mm. So whatever we have taken initially, it we don't need to change it. Okay. Okay, means we our initial consideration is correct. Why? Means for balanced section, if D is 300 mm, then if we increase the D, then the section will be under enforced and it is set, because we are in the limit state, we are designing it as an under enforced section. So that what is under enforced section? Under enforced section means the steel will yield first. During failure, the steel will yield first, then concrete will fail. So we will get a warning before the failure, because the failure of the steel will be ductile in nature. So before the failure, we will get sufficient warning. Okay. So we don't need to change the D value. Okay. The overall depth will be D equal to 450 mm. Then what will be the effective depth? Okay. This overall depth minus 5/2 minus clear cover. Okay. Take it is a nearly as 400 mm. Now we will design for what should be our main reinforcement. For main reinforcement, we will use clause 0.1.1 B of IS 456:2000 to find out the area of steel. The equation in this clause is given as mu equal to 0.87 fy ast d 1 minus ast fy by bd fck. We know that this fy means the grade of whatever the data is given. We know the this fy means grade of steel. We know the effective depth, that is the 400 mm. We know the fck grade of concrete we are taking. We know the width, as we are designing h, I am just giving the stem portion. Okay. We are giving reinforcement, this is the main reinforcement, this is 1000 mm, this is the width, okay, and this is the depth. Okay, the width will be 1000 mm and the depth will be 400, effective depth will be 400 mm. So, and we know this mu value. What is this mu value? That we have calculated here. 161 into 10 to the power 6 Newton Newton kilonewton meter. So when we put it, we will know once it is mu will be 161 into 10 to the power 6 Newton per mm equal to 0.87 FYH415. Area soil we want to find out, D will be 400. Okay, this is 1 minus 415 AST, this is 1000, D equal to 400, FCK is 20. Okay, it will be converted into quadratic equation, means we will get two values of AST. We will take more realistic value, it will be 1188.01 mm square. We are taking a nearest whole number, 1200 mm square. Okay, this is the area of the main enforcement, that is that the main enforcement. The main enforcement will be it is provided vertically. Okay, this is the main enforcement. Okay, it is provided vertically. For a 1000, we are taking 1 meter wall, means 1 meter wall length. For 1 meter wall length, what should be the spacing of the bar? If let us take, we are providing 16 mm diameter bar. Okay, then what should be the spacing of the bar? We are providing for 1000 mm length, means for 1000 mm length, what should be the spacing of this, the spacing between the bar? This is 1000 divided by the area of individual bar into multiplication by 1000 into pi by 4 into 16 square, that is the area of single bar divided by total steel area. So it will be 167.55. we are taking a lesser value for safety, let's take 150 mm, lesser whole number we are taking. So the main enforcement, the main tensile enforcement will be 16 mm dia bar at spacing center to center spacing of 150 mm in vertical direction. Okay, means the vertical bar, the spacing between the center to center spacing between the vertical bar will be 150 mm. Okay, for 1 meter running length. As we know, for design of slab, we are providing both main enforcement and distribution reinforcement. We are going to provide distribution reinforcement. Okay, distribution reinforcement. What should be distribution reinforcement? Okay, it's with the minimum steel area. So we are using the clause number 26.5.2.1 of IS 456. Okay, 2000. As per this code, the distribution bar area, the area of distribution bar will be 0.12% of overall depth, means width into overall depth, okay, overall area B into D. So 0.0012 into B into D. So 0.0012, we are taking the unit width 1000 into D equal to 450. Here it is overall depth, remember it is not effective depth, it is overall depth. Okay, it will be 540 mm square. So we are taking it for distribution enforcement, 10 mm dia bar. Okay, so what will be its spacing? As this 10 mm, I am showing it in a different color. I am showing this distribution bar as green color. Okay, the distribution reinforcement will be perpendicular to the screen. Okay, it will be spaced throughout the overall depth, that is the throughout the overall depth, overall length of 4.75 meter. Okay, then the spacing will be four seven five zero into pi by 4 into 10 square by 540. Okay, you can calculate it to kind of find out the spacing. Okay, till now we have fixed out the width of the stem at the base. Now we will do the stability check for 1 meter running length of the wall. So we have divided into its various parts so that it will be easier for us to calculate the load and the point of application of the load from the toe. Okay, we have to calculate the movement from the toe for the stability analysis. Okay, it is easier if we calculate it in a tabular form. So this is right is load, this is distance from toe, this is the toe is at point B. Okay, then movement about toe. The first, this is the compartment 1, the load will be W1 will be its dimension, means we know unit weight equal to weight by volume. So weight will be unit weight into volume. So here the unit weight of concrete is 25, RCC concrete is 25, volume we are taking the this longitudinal dimension is 1 meter. So this thickness B equal to 0.45 in this is 1 into 1. Okay, 0.45 into 1 into 1, it will be 11.25, and it will be the resultant will act at centroid at that is at 0.5 meter, and if we multiply it we will get 5.625. okay, likewise we will go on calculating. Okay, now we will write the load distance and movement about the toe. The load due to the structural elements will cause a will create a clockwise movement about the toe, so making it a stabilizing movement. And while analyzing, we also take the soil above the heel as a part of the retaining wall, and the active earth pressure will create an anti-clockwise movement, which that is the destabilizing movement, and it will act at the end of the toe region at a distance of h capital H by 3, that overall 1/3 of the overall depth. Okay, so our total movement, this movement is due to the various parts of the structure. Okay, it will create an clockwise movement. Okay, and this movement is due to the active path pressure, which will create an anti-clockwise movement. So our total movement will be 394.75 minus 107.06, that is 287.69 kilonewton meter. Okay, so what at the point where the resultant of all these forces will act. Okay, let this is the base slab. Okay, this is the toe point B. Let the resultant forces the resultant forces. Okay, this is the resultant R. It have two component. It have two component. One vertical, one horizontal. Okay, let it is acting at a distance of z from point B. So the z will be total moment by total vertical force, that is W or RV. Okay, that will be 287.69 divided by 204.85 will be 1.4 meter. Okay, eccentricity will be, if the total width of the base slab is 3 meter and the half width will be 1.5 meter, then from the half width at what distance the resultant is acting, this is the eccentricity. And the eccentricity is be b total half of the base width minus the point of application resultant force from the toe beam, from the toe, that will be 1.5 minus 1.4 equal to 0.1. As we know, I have already told you, the resultant should lie in the middle third of the base width. So the eccentricity should be less than b by 6. Okay, so it is safe. Safe in the sense that at the heel region there will be no tension will be developed. Okay, now we will do stability analysis against overturning. What is the factor of safety against overturning? That is the resisting moment by overturning moment. What will the resisting moment? 394.75. What is our overturning moment? 107.06. It is giving a value of 3.68. As I have told you, as per IS code, it should be greater than 1.55. So it is safe as compared to overturning moment. Now we have to find out what should be the base pressure distribution. Okay, this is the heel slab. The base pressure will vary as in trapezoid. Okay, maximum at the toe and minimum at the heel. Okay, the maximum base pressure P max and the minimum base pressure P min. We know the maximum base pressure value is P max equal to summation of total vertical force equal to total weight divided by B, 1 plus 6 time of eccentricity by total base width B. So when we will get it, we will 82 kilonewton per meter square. Minimum base pressure will be total weight by total base width divided by 1 minus 6 of eccentricity by B. It will be, we will get it as 55 kilonewton per meter square. So it will vary trapezoidal, it will vary linearly. At toe it will be maximum value of 82 and at heel minimum value of 55. Okay, so this is the stem part. As we know, it is varying linearly. So at stem part, what should be the value we can calculate? At this point it will be 77.18 kilonewton per meter square, and here it will be 68.9 kilonewton per meter square. Now we will go for design of heel slab. Okay, while designing the heel slab, what are the loads we will take? It is fixed in it this point. Okay, so what are the loads acting on this heel slab? Okay, the load due to the soil above the heel slab will act in the downward direction, and the self weight of the heel slab will act also in downward direction, and the uplift pressure, as I have already told you, the uplift pressure will vary in trapezoid. So here there will be uplift pressure, and here it will be another uplift pressure. Okay, it will react in vertical up direction. So at this point. The uplift pressure is 68.9, here it is 55. The downward pressure, the downward forces will be UDL due to the overburden soil, it will be 85.5 kilonewton per meter square, and due to the self weight, the load will be gamma of concrete into the thickness. Okay, it will be gamma of concrete, we are taking 25, thickness is 0.45, it will be 11.25. The pressure due to the overburden soil, we can calculate by gamma of soil into the height of overburden, that is 18 into 4.75, that will be 85.5. Okay. So now we can analyze, we can find out the total bending moment. Okay, our bending, we will get the maximum bending moment which will occur at the fixed support at 46 kilonewton per meter. I am not solving it as I have very less time. Okay, then our design moment will be 1.5 times of bending moment. Okay, that is the 69 kilonewton per meter. 1.5 times of 46 will be 69 kilonewton per meter cube. Due to, as we know, as we can see, as the downward force is greater than upward force, so the heel will bend like this. So tension will develop at the top face. So we have to provide the tension reinforcement, main tension reinforcement at the top, and the main tension reinforcement at the top, it should be horizontal. This is the main tension reinforcement. Okay. Now we have to calculate the main tension reinforcement, and it should be provided throughout the unit length. Okay, I am giving a two-dimensional picture. If it is three-dimension, at a specific gap, we will provide the main reinforcement. So, what is our area of the main reinforcement? We'll again use the clause G1.1b of IS456. That is, you will use the equation mu equal to 0.87 fy ast d 1 minus ast fy bd fck, and here we will find out the ast h nearly h 500 mm square. So what should be the spacing? Okay, here if we use 12 mm dia bar, okay, then the spacing will be, we are spreading it throughout the length, this 1000 mm, that is into 5 by 4 into 12 square divided by the area of the total reinforcement equal to 500, which will be 226.19. we are taking a lesser spacing, that is 200 mm center to center. This is the main reinforcement, and as we know, we also have to provide distribution reinforcement, and I have already told you distribution reinforcement, we can use the clause 26.5.2.1 to give the distribution reinforcement. It will be 0.0012 into overall area, that is B into overall depth, 0.0012 width 1000 mm. Okay, H we are designing the hill slab is like this. This is the three-dimensional diagram of the hill slab. Okay, and we are providing, okay, I am representing the main reinforcement in red color, we are providing the main enforcement in this direction, okay, and distribution enforcement perpendicular to the main reinforcement, okay. So distribution, so the area where we are providing the main reinforcement, the width is B and depth is D, okay. B is 1000 and depth D is 450 mm, that is the thickness of the base slab. And we will find out as 540 mm square. If we are providing 12 mm dia bar as distribution enforcement, and it will be spaced throughout the slab, throughout the hill region. The hill region will be is 1.5 meter. The length of the hill region is 1.55 meter, okay, and then it will be spaced, the spacing will be 1550 mm into pi by 4 12 square divided by 540, it will be 324 mm center to center. Let's take it 300 mm center to center, okay. Now we will go for design of toe slab, okay. This is similar to the design of hill slab. I am not going into detail, okay. We are taking the toe slab will be, while designing, we are considering toe slab is fixed at this point. The load acting at the load above the soil above the toe slab, the self weight and the upload pressure acting in upward direction, okay. In the, if when in generally in case of toe slab, okay, toe slab is fixed in this point, the upload pressure, the upload pressure which is acting trapezoidally and the downward forces due to the soil plus self weight of concrete, okay. The overall effect will be that the it will bend in upward direction, so tension will develop in bottom face, okay. So as tension will develop, it is bending in this fashion, the tension will develop in bottom face. So in hill region we have to provide the tension reinforcement in the bottom face, okay. In the hill region we are providing the top face, because bending it is bending downward direction, the tension will develop in the top, but in hill region the tension is developing at the bottom, okay. We can calculate the design at the moment when will maximum bending moment that will occur at the junction. It will be 26.54 kilonewton meter. The design moment will be 1.5 times of this 1.5 times of m, it will be 39.81 kilonewton meter, okay. So we will calculate the main enforcement, that we will use that clause 0 g 1.1b and find out the area of steel. It will be 540 mm square. It will if we will take 12 mm diameter bar, then it will be 200 mm center to center spacing. The distribution enforcement, okay. I am giving a picture to read here. This is the This is a three-dimensional representation of the hill. Let's in the blue color, we are representing the main enforcement. Okay. And the distribution reinforcement we are representing in green color. It is provided in the bottom portion. At the end, I will also tell you that in the top portion, means in the bottom portion, we are calculating what should be the main reinforcement and distribution reinforcement, but at the top portion, what should we provide. Okay. We have calculated the main enforcement, it is 540 mm square, and the distribution enforcement it will be 0.0012 into B into D. Here B is 1000, D is 450 mm. Okay, we will find out it, it will be also 540 mm square. Now we will go for check for safety against sliding. Okay. Safety against sliding. We know to, we have calculated what is the total active earth pressure. Okay. Total active earth pressure is 1/2 of Ka gamma H overall H square, and it will be 81.12 kilonewton, and the coefficient of friction will be 0.5. The frictional force developed will be mu times of total vertical weight, that is the 0.5. We have calculated the total weight. Okay. Here, this is 204.85, 0.5 times 204.85, 102.4. Okay. Now we will calculate the factor of safety against sliding. The resisting force will be mu times of W. The sliding force will be active earth pressure 102.4 by 81.12. We are getting 1.26, but it should be less than 1.55. So it is not safe against sliding. So what should we do? We can increase the sliding resistance by providing an shear key. This shear key will create the shear key will add passive earth pressure, making by the passive earth pressure it is increasing the resistance force. Okay, so what should be the depth of this shear key? Okay, let take the depth of the shear key h y. Okay, the passive earth pressure will be 1/2 of the kp passive earth coefficient into gamma into y square. Okay. Now the factor of safety against sliding will be mu times of W, that is a frictional force, plus passive earth pressure and divided by the active earth pressure. So we will take different values of y and put into the passive earth pressure, so that our factor safety will be greater than 1.55. Okay, let's take y value as 450 mm. Okay, then our factor of safety will come out to be 2.45, that is greater than 1.55. So it is safe against sliding. Now we will check for shear. Check for shear at this junction point of stem. Okay. So it is a, the stem is a, we are taking a fixed beam. The earth pressure acting, this active earth pressure is acting in direction, and the passive earth pressure is acting, the passive earth pressure here is acting, and the active earth pressure is acting in this direction. Okay. Then the total shear force, if we calculate, the active earth pressure will calculate, it will act in this direction, okay, and the passive earth pressure will act in this direction, okay. So the active earth pressure, what is the magnitude of the active earth pressure? The area of this triangle, this which is K gamma H, H is here 4.75 mm, okay. And in this portion, the H will be 0.75, the soil over toe region, okay. Here it will be passive earth pressure will act, Kp gamma H1, okay. The passive earth pressure force will be, this is active earth pressure, this is passive earth pressure, okay. And the shear will develop, shear resistance will develop in this direction. The shear resistance V, the if we use the Newton's law of equilibrium, total force in the direction will be 0. So V plus P1 equal passive earth pressure Pp equal to active earth pressure. So if we calculate the V, your active earth pressure will be half of this area, that will be half of 1/3 K gamma H, gamma equal to 18, the 4.75, it will be 68.28 kilonewton. Passive earth pressure will be half into Kp, Kp is here 3, gamma is 18, H equal to 0.75, it will be, passive earth pressure will be 15.19. So V will be 68.28 minus 15.19 equal to 53.09, okay. What will be our design shear force? Our design shear force is 1.5 times of V, that will be 1.5 times of 17 is 9.635, okay. Now what will the nominal shear stress, nominal shear stress tau v, to calculate nominal shear stress we are using clause number 40.1 of IS 456, which gives, it is the ratio of design shear force divided by area, effective area BD, that will be 79.65, converting it into kilonewton to newton into 10 by 3, where B equal to 1000, D equal to 400, it will be 0.199 kilonewton per meter square. Okay. Research have given that in case of a RCC beam where we only provide a tensile reinforcement and no shear reinforcement provided, in that case also the beam have that beam have certain design shear strength that we call tau c. This tau c value is a function of grade of concrete and percentage of steel, that is percent of steel is 100 times of area of tension steel divided by effective area. Okay. In clause in the table 19 of IS 456, from this grade of concrete and percentage steel, we can find out the design shear strength without shear reinforcement. Okay. In case of stem, our area of main reinforcement is 1200 mm². So, percentage of steel will be 100 into area of steel, that is 1200, the effective area will be 1000 into 400. It will be 0.3. For M20 grade concrete of area of percentage steel 0.3, the tau C, the shear strength, is generally the shear strength will be near to 0.4, but the shear stress developed is 0.2. Okay. So, the tau V is less than tau C. So, it is safe against shear. So, no shear reinforcement is provided. Okay. Till now, I have told you where to provide the main reinforcement. Okay. In the hill region, we are providing it at top. In the toe region, we are providing it at bottom. In the stem, we are providing the inner surface. Okay. And the distribution reinforcement are provided in perpendicular direction to this. But in this opposite direction, we are providing the reinforcement half of the distribution reinforcement we are provided in the inner surface. Okay. So, in this surface, we are providing the main reinforcement as in the outer face, main reinforcement we are providing half of distribution reinforcement, and distribution reinforcement also half of distribution reinforcement. This reinforcement, and here also we are providing in the opposite face. Here also we are providing the opposite face, and we are also curtailing, extending this stem reinforcement into the shear key. Okay. The reinforcement, this reinforcement, okay, these are just provided to take care of tensile stress and tension and shrinkage. Okay. They are not taking any flexure.